Okay, so a little bit about the cell wall and the ultrastructure of the cell wall. Basically, we have two main layers in the cell wall, the wood cell wall. We have the primary layer, which is not too surprising to hear that the primary layer is the first one that's laid down when the cell is growing in the vascular cambium in the wood tissue. So when the cell's still alive, the primary layer's laid down. Then later on, the secondary layers are laid down and we get all sorts of processes taking place with the laying down of the secondary layer prior to lignification. And then once the lignification process takes place, the cell is dead. So the lignification process and the reason for the presence of lignin is to give the wood its structural stiffness. If we didn't have lignin present in the wood, trees wouldn't be able to reach anything like the heights that they can reach. It would be impossible. So lignin is a very important polymer from that point of view, but I'm not talking about lignin here. I'm talking about the structure of the cell wall. So the primary layer is the one that's on the outside. You'll see lots and lots of different drawings of the wood cell wall. Sometimes they're drawn square and sometimes they're drawn in a circular fashion. More often than not, they tend to be in softwoods at least, a square shape. In hardwoods, they tend to be a bit rounder, I think, but it doesn't really matter the exact shape because it does vary from species to species and tree to tree. The main difference between these layers is in the structure that the microfibrils have. The primary layer has got a very loose assembly of microfibrils, which have a sort of a crisscross pattern, but I don't think there's anything regular to it. And this layer is basically designed to be very flexible, is to allow the cell to expand longitudinally, to expand length, to expand sideways as the cell is growing. The secondary layer, that's the primary layer. The S1 layer, which is next to the primary, has a number of what are called lamellae, where there is a microfibrilla, microfibrils are laid down in a pattern, but each of these lamellae, or each lamella, which is a lamella is the singular, has the same orientation, but the ultimate result is that you get this crisscross pattern, but it's laid down in lamellae. So you get one lamella will have one orientation, the next one will have another. So this does give some structural stiffness to the cell wall, and it provides some sort of restraint on the cell wall expanding because of this crisscross pattern. Then we have an S2 layer, which is the thickest layer of all of them. So I'll draw it like that. There's another layer on the inside, which I'll draw in a minute. And this has the microfibrillar orientation quite often, quite a steep angle. So it's quite a strong layer in tension. And all the microfibrils are laid down with one particular orientation, and that orientation can either be a Z orientation, so that's a Z direction, that's the cell wall axis, so that's the top of the tree there, that's the axis of the tree, and that's the cell wall axis, so that's a Z orientation there. Or you can have an S orientation, and you don't get them mixed up in the layers, basically. So you either have that orientation or that orientation, but you won't get a mixture of the two. That doesn't have such a restraining effect on the cell wall expanding, but it has one of the important factors about that type of orientation is it allows for a sort of helical unwinding process to take place with the cell, which is an energy losing mechanism. And it's one of the reasons why wood is so tough. So if it gets down to the point where failure is occurring in the cell wall, this unwinding of this S2 layer actually absorbs a lot of energy and makes wood a very, very tough structure, which is one of the reasons that people that make composites try and emulate the structure of wood. On the inside of this, we then have a S3 layer, the last of the secondary layers. And that S3 layer, again, has a restraining influence. It usually has quite a a sharp angle. Now, I've been looking this up, and sometimes this is drawn with one orientation, and sometimes it's drawn with a crisscross pattern. So if the people that write textbooks don't know how this structure is formed, then I certainly can't tell you. So you will find a mixture of structures drawn there. I haven't got to the bottom of this, to be quite honest. The thing about this, though, is that that microfibular angle is much greater than the microfibular angle of the S2 layer. You do get variations with these types of things. With tension wood, which is a wood that forms in hardwoods, tension wood. I have to apologise for this pen constantly. That S2 layer is almost vertical. So obviously that is to take the tensile forces. And you also get something quite often in tension, which is called a G layer, which is an extra layer that stands for gel layer. In compression wood, which you get in softwoods, compression wood, this pen is running out. That S2 winding layer is like that. That's better. Not exactly horizontal, but a much larger microfibular angle there. That's called the microfibular angle. And obviously here that the wood isn't, or the tree isn't worried about applying tension to this. So the structure is there to resist compression rather than tension. If you have a layout where the microfibrils go like this, there's less restraint on expansion, whereas it's like a hoop on a barrel. If the layers are much more like that, it stops the cell wall from expanding outwards. So this S1, S3 layers control the expansion of the cell wall quite significantly. And there's one other layer that isn't part of the cell wall, but is actually the layer that bonds the cell walls together. It's highly lignified, and that is referred to as the middle. It's always very difficult drawing and writing close up, so you should try it. Try it at home. There we are, the middle lamella. Here we are, the cell wall.